This is Rio of Madison Rising, and you're listening to our acoustic version of the Star Spangled Banner here on KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so bright? Twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallant.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign. KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark. God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin can now be heard Monday through Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Saturday and Sunday mornings at 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern. Join him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord, right here on KLRN Radio and the Spark Radio Network. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books.
Each of my programs are being saved so that you can listen to them at any time. There's just 4 simple steps to find the past programs. Go to www.spreaker.com. That's S-P-R-E-A-K-E-R.com. Enter my name, Richard Hardin, in the search box in the top center of the home page. Click on the brown icon, which has the Bible, 2 candlesticks, and a cross in the background. A list of my programs will come up.
You're listening to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin. Richard will guide you through the Bible and help you find God's purpose for your life. Now here's teacher and author Richard Hardin.
Welcome to God's Pure Word of Faith. I'm Richard Hardin, and again, I want to thank the Lord and the management of KLRN Radio for this great opportunity to share God's Word with you today. Today, I want to share with you about some errors that are being taught in our society. The reason I keep, mention this because, like the title of the program, God's Pure Word of Faith, God will only back up His pure Word. In Proverbs chapter 30, verses 5 and 6, it says, "Every word of God is pure, a shield to them that put their trust in. Add thou not to it, lest he reprove thee, and thou be found a liar." See, if we change any of God's Word, we're supposed to be His ambassadors to share His Word as Christians. You know, we're the people that are be sharing with other people in our neighborhood, the people we meet throughout the daytime and like this. And as ministers and teachers, you know, especially as we stand before people, or as I come before you this morning, I'm supposed to be sharing God's pure Word with you, and I'm trying to. And if I miss that and I'm not sharing God's pure Word, well, I'll be found a liar because God won't back up what I'm saying to you. And see, that's how important it is. When we share with someone about salvation, we should be sharing clearly as we can to that individual, so that when they respond in however way we, you know, kind of give them guidance or something, that they should be able then to turn to the Lord and respond in the way we tell them to and encourage them to, and they should be able to receive the changed heart, changed life, the Spirit of Christ in their heart, and become a child of God too. You know, we should be sharing with them that accurately that they'll know exactly what to do. Now, they still will have to make the choice themselves if they're going to do it or not, but it shouldn't be because that we've given them misinformation or because we've, you know, just confused them or something, and give them part of the information. And then like this, you know, we should, as Christians, be able to go forth sharing God's pure word, especially about salvation. Now, a lot of these other beliefs in our society, too, we need to, because as a person starts trying to grow in the Lord and you'll receive more of God's word, there's so many different beliefs being taught in our society. And I want to share some of those with you today. I may have to run over to share some Sunday, but I'm not going to go into as much depth today in most of these, because if you look back at my podcast, I have now had over 100 broadcasts, and some of the podcasts deal with just specific subjects. So if you would find my podcast, you can look back and see in a lot more detail. But today I want to try to bring you as many of them as I can real quick, just to show you the condition that our society's in. It's not just one wrong belief. It's so many different wrong beliefs that you wonder, you know, how can all these different groups claim to be Christians and be teaching so many different subjects in different ways? Today I want to, well, to continue on in that particular direction there, we shouldn't be teaching in all these different ways. We're given instructions like in what is Ephesians 4. The Apostle Paul says, or as the scripture says here, there's one body, one spirit, even as you're called, in one hope of your calling. Now, there's one hope of our calling too, which I will mention again in just a minute. But it says one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all, through all, and in you all. Well, this one faith, see, is the one faith that we're all supposed to be looking to receive and then to share with others once we get it established in our heart and everything. In Hebrews 11:6, it says that we must understand faith. Our only way to correctly respond to God is through faith. It says, without faith it is impossible to please God, for he that cometh to God must not only believe that he is, but that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. See, but we can only respond to God positively by faith. Now, what is faith? That's one of the first things that there's a lot of confusion about in our society. Well, on down in the same chapter, Ephesians 4, 13, verses 11 through 13, it says he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, pastors, teachers, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying, building up in the body of Christ, till we all come into the unity of the faith, that one faith that it was talking about, and of a knowledge of the Son of God, into a perfect man, into the measure of stature of fullness of Christ. Now, the very next verse says, and until we come into that unity of the one faith, listen to what it says about our society. This is describing our society, because our society, with the 200 or 300 different denominations and all these different groups and everything like this claiming to be Christian, we certainly do not have a unity in our society. So listen to what the Apostle Paul says in here in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 14. Therefore, no, that we henceforth be no more children, babes in Christ, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sly of men. Now, the sly of men is what's going on in our society today. Everybody's come up with these new theories and these ideas and everything, and, you know, and a lot of people will jump on board, and then it'll just get accepted throughout our society, and without people verifying it from the scriptures and everything in a lot of cases. Now, this is what's going on in our society. It's like babes in Christ. Don't know the truth. Don't know the fundamentals, the foundation of faith. And like I was saying a while ago, that one faith. Now, what is that one faith? Faith comes from hearing God's word. Faith comes from hearing. It's Romans 10:17. Faith comes by hearing. Hearing by the word of God. Now, but it's not just hearing his word and then you deciding, well, this is what his word means. This is what it means and everything. You have to, you know, seek to find out, you know, in like different beliefs in the scripture like this, to make a study like this until you know that God has spoken to you. Now, when he speaks, it's not just you hearing in your head and then deciding to go out and do things. It's like the, Psalms 119:9 says, "Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way?" It says, by taking heed thereto according to God's word. Receiving God's word into, your heart, and allowing him to come in and speak and live in your heart. And so it's not just what we make up and want to be God's word, but you can see that's what's happened in our society, is that people are, studying the scriptures, like one version, King James, NIV or something, and they're making up their beliefs and in teaching and going from that. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, it says that I, brethren, could not speak unto you as spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto you are not able to bear it, neither can you yet are you able. For are you not yet carnal? For whereas there is among you envying and strife and divisions, and look at all the strife and divisions in our Christian society today. So many different things about gays, and so many things about women ministers, and even a large church not long ago, nationwide church, Presbyterian, took the song, Jesus is the only way, the one on solid rock I stand, no other ground is, all other ground is sinking sand. Well, taking this out, that they're saying Jesus is not the only way. Now, all through here, the scripture shows that it's unity in belief. It's unity in receiving God's word, because he won't tell each of us different things if we're seeking God with all our heart. He'll give us one answer to different things. And it's that unity then of going together in the faith that's going to be able to be victorious in our society today. Because we're not joined together in Christian communities and in unity of belief and everything. Here, the Apostle Paul was talking to the Corinthians about just two beliefs that were causing them to be separated. Say that, I am of Paul, and another says I'm of Apollos. Says, are you not carnal? It's just a difference of two, and we have hundreds of different differences in our beliefs in the Christian community, and this is what we need to our ministers, like it said there in Ephesians 4 verses 11 through 13, that the apostles, prophets, preachers, evangelists, and teachers, for the perfecting of saints, for the work of the ministry, edifying body, till we come into the unity of the one faith. We should only have one group of people calling themselves Christians, born again, when people have the Spirit of Christ in their heart and know that we're a child of God. Have you received the changed heart? See, it's not just you deciding, I'm going to serve the Lord, and then so you supposedly try to clean up your life and put on a suit or something and start going to church and carrying the Bible and being what you call a Christian. That doesn't make a person a Christian. What makes a person a Christian is like God speaking through the prophet Ezekiel, said in Ezekiel 36:26, God says, a new heart also will I give you, a new spirit will I put within you. I'll take away the stony heart of your flesh, give you heart of flesh, and I'll put my spirit in you. See, and that when he puts his spirit in us, that's when we become a child of God. Romans 8:9 says, now if any man have not the spirit of Christ, he is none of his. So all this stuff we do beforehand in reaching out to God and everything, it's got to be with all our heart for him to respond. Jeremiah 29:13, you shall seek me and find me when you search me with all your heart. And that's the way it's always been with God. We got to come to him with a wholehearted, honest, commitment and prayer. And then he responds by putting his spirit in us and creating in us a new heart, a new life. And that's what we call a work of grace. when we respond to his words, what we call faith, our acceptance of his word that we're a sinner, that we need Jesus, and that we're going to turn to him with all our heart. See, our response to his word is our faith then, by accepting his word to faith into our hearts. And but then when his spirit comes into our heart, his words are spirit and they're life, when they come into our heart and we invite him to come in, then the work of his spirit in our heart to create the new heart, new life, that's a work of grace then that what changes our heart. He gives us a new heart, a clean heart, puts his spirit in us, and now we're children of God. See, and that's how we're saved by grace, through faith, through our acceptance of his word and everything. Now, so until we come into that one unity of the spirit, we need to be teaching and preaching and trying to draw people together. We need a better image in this society. Our Christian society doesn't project the happy, joyful, Christian, changed heart people that other people will see that they're missing something. See, we should be sharing testimonies like Revelation 12:11. It says, you know, that and they overcame him, speaking of the devil, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. See, the word of our testimony and the words of our life, how we're living, how, you know, God is blessing us and answering our prayers and like this. And they see something in us that they feel like they're missing. But it's not that way in our society. We have so many different denominations fussing, arguing back and forth and everything. Now, like in 2 Chronicles 7:14, though. 2 Chronicles 7:14, where so many of you have heard this. It's been over and over. But there's a little phrase in here that doesn't seem to get much emphasis. It says, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face, turn from their wicked ways. Now, he's talking about his people. And that goes for us today, too. And I'm going to show you what some of the wicked ways are that we in our society need to turn from. It says, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. He'll heal our land. He promised the children of Israel that he'd give them the waters in the springtime, the waters for the harvest, and, you know, like this. He'd, you know, give them the sunshine they need and everything. Their crops would, you know, flourish and just be a blessing to them and everything. He promised to do all that, and he'll do it for us again too in our society. But this little expression says, turn from their wicked ways. What are the wicked ways in our society today? The first one I already mentioned, the division, the lack of unity, the lack of people seeking God's pure word of faith. And when you add to anything from the Lord, he won't back it up, because then it's not his word. See, God's word is Christ. Christ, the living word. John chapter 1. In the beginning was the word, and the word was God, and the word was God, and is God. It's Christ, the living word. God spoke, let there be light. His word went forth. But see, now, when he speaks his word to us and we receive his pure word, if we share his pure word and it goes forth, he'll back it up too. He'll back up his pure word regardless. Even the donkey in the book of Numbers, you know, when God spoke through that donkey to Balaam, God backed up his word through that donkey. And he'll back us up too if we're speaking his word. But there's so much confusion and everything that we don't have that unity of word and belief. But it says that his people now, that we, as his representative today, we're supposed to be ambassadors speaking his pure word. We have no authority to change his word. And that's how we'll be found a liar if we do change it, add to it, or take from it. Then he won't back it up. But now, it says, turn from their wicked ways. One of the first wicked ways is discussed about Rehoboam in 2 Chronicles 12:14. It says that Rehoboam did evil because he prepared not his heart to seek the Lord. So many people today are just going to church, carrying their Bibles, and throwing money in the offering plate or something, and expecting the preachers to go visit in hospitals, you know, help take care of the needy and all this. They have programs to do all this and everything. Just giving their money, but not their heart and time. They're expecting the preachers to take care of all this stuff for them. And so they've checked off the block, you know, because they've given their money. Well, each of us has a special holy calling. 2 Timothy 1:9, it says, He saved us and called us to a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace created in Christ Jesus before the world began. Now, that holy calling is so special for each of us. If you are not seeking your holy calling, or if you didn't even know you had a holy calling, see, you have been living an evil life up until now. Ignorance is no excuse. If you look in the scriptures, if I could find it real quick here in Proverbs, it says that God knows our hearts and he knows why we haven't taken the time to seek him. He knows our thoughts and all this stuff. So all these thoughts we've had about, well, we don't want to really do this, we don't want to do that, we're going to have to answer for those when, you know, the time comes. Excuse me. I hope I can find that real quick here now. I didn't have that one marked, but we're all expected then. Oh, here it is. Saying you don't know something won't be a very good excuse when you stand at the judgment seat of Christ alone before the holy God, before him and his radiance, his power and his glory and everything like this. And when he asks you something, you say, well, I didn't know. See, and he say, why didn't you come to me? Why didn't you turn to me? Something. But anyway, it says here in chapter 24, verse 12, if thou sayest, behold, we knew it not, does not he, God, that pondereth the heart, consider it? And he that keepeth thy soul, does he not know it? And shall not he render to every man according to his work? See, so our lack of knowledge or ignorance is not going to be a very good answer to have to give at the judgment seat of Christ. Because, see, he knows our hearts. He knows what opportunities he gave us. He knows the talents. He knows the things that we, the decisions that we made through our younger years to go certain ways. And he knows when we left him out of those decisions, and he will remember them. And they will come before you at the judgment seat of Christ. Even as Christians, it says that we're going to answer for the good and bad. Now, I don't know how we're going to answer for the bad or what, you know, like that. It doesn't say. But I know that I don't want to stand there and have to answer to him and say that, you know, I didn't care enough about the salvation you gave me that I didn't want to, you know, prepare myself to help share with others. See, I tell you, in 1974, when the Lord came into my heart, when Christ came into my heart and created me a new heart, new life, I thought everybody should know. Such a great change took place in me because I knew what was in my heart before. And when I called out to the Lord that night and he heard and answered me, it was so fantastic and everything that everybody ought to know. Because, you know, I knew the way of the world. I, you know, the heart full of hate and lust and all these type things like this. And when he erased that, like Ezekiel 36:26 says, a new heart also will give you, a new spirit will I put within you. I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh, give you a heart of flesh, and put my spirit in you. When that happened to me, I thought everybody ought to know. Not just know what happened to me, but know what happened to me that can happen to you also. See, I know God will back that up. If you call out to the Lord right now with all your heart and say, Lord, please forgive me. Come into my heart. Change my heart. Like he's talking about and everything. I know God will do it. But like in Jeremiah 29:13, you shall seek me and find me when, excuse me, you search for me with all your heart. It's got to be a wholehearted commitment and call out to the Lord of wanting to turn from your sin and turn to him. And he'll hear an answer. And then the wicked ways, see, now the one of the first wicked ways is that a person, well, I hate to say this, but too lazy to seek God or don't want to be identified as a person that, you know, you want to go out and work and make a lot of money and be successful in the eyes of people and things like this and just invent something or be famous and everything and just have everybody respect you and everything like that. And you don't want to, you know, have people when, you know, they ask you what you're doing and everything, you say, well, I'm a preacher or I'm this or that or whatever, you know, like that. But to associate it with, you know, just serving the Lord, people kind of turn and look the other way or something. But now, It's evil not to seek the Lord. You're missing blessings. Your wife or children or husbands or whoever it is missing blessings. Your family's missing blessings. Everybody's missing blessings if you aren't seeking the Lord's holy calling for your life. And it's evil not to. Now, failing to seek that holy calling. And something else about the holy calling. 2 Timothy 1:9 says, He saved us and called us to holy calling, not according to our works, but according to His own purpose and grace created in Christ Jesus before the world began. There is no place in there to where it says that there's a permissive will. See, he doesn't say if you seek and I reveal to you my holy calling and let you know what it is, then if you don't like it, well, why don't you just do what you want to do and I'll bless it. No, there's no provision in here for a permissive will. He has a holy calling for each one of us, and he knows what's best for us. He knows what he created us for, and he knows where you're going to receive the most blessings, and you and your family and everything. So, see, we've got to accept and receive his holy calling to faith. That is, when we hear God's word, hear his will for us, we've got to receive it into our heart to faith. Because, see, if we reject it, it's unbelief, like the children of Israel. When they came up to the promised land, his holy calling for them was to cross over the Jordan into the promised land. But the 12 spies sent out to spy out the land and to spy out the best way to cross over into the land. 10 of them came back and said, there's giants over there. We can't do it. You know, we're grasshoppers to them. The people then turned because of those 10 spies and rejected going across the Jordan, which was God's holy calling to them. And when they rejected him, it says in the Hebrews chapter 3, verses 12 through 19, it says, in rejecting the living God, they rejected to unbelief. And it says, because of unbelief. See, it wasn't doubt. Doubt is when you don't know God's will. It's a head problem. You set yourself to seek the Lord and find out his will. But when you know God's will, when he's revealed his will to you, unbelief is when you knowingly reject his will, like the children of Israel did. They rejected, in departing from the living God, they rejected unbelief and failed to enter in because of an evil heart of unbelief. See, unbelief is a heart problem. You know God's will, but you don't love him or care enough to seek his holy calling. You don't care enough to do what he's asked you to do. Or you let what you think others will think about you, you know, you're afraid of the image that you'll project and everything. If you start telling people about Jesus, if you start talking about the Lord too much, you know, your family members say, well, you better cool it. You're getting a little bit too, you know, rowdy or something. Well, anyway, but there's no such thing as permissive will. Now, God doesn't strike people down and kill us, you know, like it when we aren't doing his holy calling or seeking his holy calling. But he's still trying to encourage us to. See, he's trying to lead us into that because he knows that's what's best for us. What is it? Psalms 16:11 says, Thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. You'll never have that self-esteem, feeling successful or feeling good in your heart about what you're doing and everything. And having that peace of knowing that you're doing it with the Lord until you allow him to lead you into that holy calling. And it's evil if you don't care enough and love him enough to do that. In 2 Chronicles chapter 2, verse 10 through 11, it says, Forgive others, lest you give Satan advantage. You see, there's things as we are walking this life, We've got to forgive others if we expect to receive the blessings of God as we go. Because we're giving Satan advantage anytime we hold unforgiveness against anyone. I don't care what they've done for you. I sit here and say that because I remember things back in my past like that. But I know what it's like to have forgiveness in my heart for people that you know, have hurt you or done things like this. And it'll happen again. I'm sure it'll happen again before I leave this world. I'll have to, you know, forgive people for different things. It's hard to do. But see, it's God's will for us, because when we're holding unforgiveness, we're blocking God's love in our heart through us to that other person. And when we're blocking God's love from our heart, He can't forgive us, because we're the one making the choice to block His love from our heart. So that's why the scriptures say so many times, you know, that forgive others, lest your heavenly Father won't forgive you. Even in the Lord's Prayer, so many people will pray today. They'll pray and say, forgive us our sins as we forgive those that sin against us, or as we forgive our debtors. And in a sense, almost like they're praying to not get their prayers answered if they're holding unforgiveness to anyone. Well, I'll take a short break and I'll be right back.
Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books.
Each of my programs are being saved so that you can listen to them at any time. There's just 4 simple steps to find the past programs. Go to www.spreaker.com. That's spreaker.com. Enter my name, Richard Hardin, in the search box in the top center of the home page. Click on the brown icon, which has the Bible, 2 candlesticks, and a cross in the background. A list of my programs will come up.
God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin can now be heard Monday through Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Saturday and Sunday mornings at 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern. Join him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord, right here on KLRN Radio and the Spark Radio Network.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign. KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
You're listening to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin. Richard will guide you through the Bible and help you find God's purpose for your life. Now here's teacher and author Richard Hardin.
Share with you some of the things in our society that is really causing us as Christians to have a bad influence, because it's causing us to be out of fellowship with God, and God is not hearing and blessing us, you know, like He wants to, because, you know, we're blocking His blessings. Well, just like in the scripture I just shared, you know, right before the break, was that, you know, when we fail to forgive, we're failing to allow God's love in us, in our heart, through our heart, to someone else. And when we reject God's love from coming into our heart, see, we're out of fellowship with Him. And like it says then, that forgive others, lest you give Satan advantage. And that's how that we are giving Satan advantage, is when we're blocking God's love from coming into our heart. Because see, He loves that person that He wants us to forgive. He didn't like what they did to us, and it wasn't God working through that person to hurt us. But yet, He wants us to forgive that person so that He can work to try to draw that person and help that person be delivered from the devil using him to hurt people like he hurt you or hurt me. See, so if we're failing to, you know, allow God's love in us for that person, then we're out of fellowship with God. We're going to miss blessings. Our family's going to miss blessings. Your job will miss blessings, or your church will miss blessings. You know, Everything associated with you will miss blessings as long as you're holding unforgiveness toward even one person. Because, see, you're blocking the living God from coming into your heart for that person and not allowing him. You're refusing to allow him to use you to help draw that person to him. And it's so serious. Even Jesus on the cross, after all the persecution he went through, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." See, he was expressing his love through, you know, himself back to his Father for all those people out there, even all the bad things they had done to him. And like I mentioned before, you know, that ignorance is not going to count when we stand before the Lord. Like at Proverbs 24:12, where it says, God knows our heart. He knows why we're making the choices we're making. And he's going to remember them. So just acting like, you know, well, I didn't really know or something like that. I can remember back when I was a kid or something like that. You know, I was pretty sure that the Lord wanted me to preach at about age 15 or 16. But with all my buddies and friends around and everything, I wouldn't have expressed that out loud to them or something, because of all of our beliefs and everything. I grew up in this children's home where ministers were the leaders of the children's home. And some of them, they lied to us so much and they did so many things that you could say, well, man, if that's what being a preacher is, you know, something like that, I didn't want anything to do with it. And it never dawned on me that you don't have to be that way, you know, just because they are, you know, you wouldn't have to be that way. But I wouldn't go forward when the messages were preached, you know, where God was tugging on my heart to go forward and everything. And I found out later that it wasn't he was wanting me to go forward to surrender to preach. He is wanting me to go forward just to surrender my heart and life to him, because I'd never done it before. And then I found out later in life, you know, years later, that I had never received Christ as my personal Lord and Savior. When I was 9 years old, all I did was just go forward and answer the preacher's question, got baptized and said, you know, joined the church and started calling myself a Christian. I said, yeah, I'm a Christian. I ain't perfect, but I'm a Christian. I knew I wasn't perfect. And I thought I was a Christian, but I wasn't. I had not received anything into my heart. I had just done what the adults told me to do, checked off the block, and that was it. But now, ignorance is not going to be bliss when we stand before the Lord. You know, say, what you don't know won't hurt you. Well, it will too. It'll hurt you a bunch. And like in Philippians 2:14, it says, do all things without complaining and arguing. Now, we can't do those things perfectly, and we all know that. So you say, well, we can't do that. That's impossible, everything. But yet the attitude of doing that is saying, Lord, help me to be that way. Help me to change. Help me to become the type of person that when I do catch myself arguing, catch myself complaining and fussing, that right then I stop it and turn to you for help and strength and everything. And James 3:16 says, where there's envy and strife, there's confusion and every evil work. Every evil work, even in deacons' meetings, the devil is in there causing confusion and strife and everything. Anytime the church really starts getting on board trying to reach out to lost people, there'll be people, you know, fussing and fighting. We need to use the money for this. We need to do this, you know, different things like this. Envying and strife is evidence that the devil is present, doing his job, trying to separate people from God and trying to hinder the work of reaching out to lost people. 1 Peter 3:7, husbands, dwell with your wives according to knowledge, being joint heirs of grace of life, lest your prayers be hindered. See, being out of fellowship with your husband, your wife, your children, or whatever, you know, or just people at work, any type of, you know, separation like that that's creating this division and everything, envying and strife and confusion, every evil work. We're also like when husbands and wives and family members and things like this are in out, that's going to cause people's prayers to be hindered. Now, when your prayers are being hindered, that means your answers from God are being hindered, coming back to you. You're going to miss blessings. And when you miss blessings, you're going to miss that joy that you would have received from the blessing. And your family's going to miss you receiving that joy. And they're going to miss blessings. See, so anytime you do anything that hinders you from getting answers to prayer, then it's going to affect everybody associated with you and your life. Teaching error is something, you know, ministers and things like this, it's going to cause to be out of fellowship and mislead people. See where like it said up there, where there's envy and strife, there's confusion. Every work, the devil wants to create confusion. And if he can cause people out of pride to start teaching something a little bit different way and think it's cute or something like that, and one of the scriptures that affects us so much in our society is the what people call faith around our society. So when he looked to Hebrews 11:1, say that Hebrews 11:1 is God's definition of faith. And it's not. Hebrews 11:1 is a true statement, but it is not a definition of faith. Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. What that is saying is that when your hopes are being fulfilled, it's faith, the substance that's fulfilling and providing those hopes to be fulfilled, even though we can't see it. But see, we have the evidence that it's faith doing it because we see our hopes being fulfilled. Now, a little bit different way, I'd use an example of like going into a dark room at nighttime. Our hope is to flip a light switch and that the electricity will flow through the circuit and through the light, and the light will turn on and brighten the room. That's our hope. That's why, you know, the circuits are all hooked up there and everything ready. So you walk up to a dark room, you flip the light switch, and a light comes on. You can say electricity is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. See, you don't see the electricity, but it's evident that it's there because the light comes on showing you that the electricity has gone through and done what it's supposed to do. Well, that's the way it is with faith. You know, you don't see the faith, but when you see your hopes being fulfilled, you know the faith is there because it's God working, you know, with you and through your faith, you know, like that, for your hopes to be fulfilled. But that's not a definition of faith. You couldn't say electricity. The definition of electricity is the substance fulfilling our hope to turn on the light. When we flip the light switch, that wouldn't be any definition of electricity. But it's true. It is electricity that goes through the circuit causing the light to come on when you flip the switch. See, it's a true statement. Or like in a windmill or something like that, you put out there to generate electricity. You say, wind is the substance fulfilling our hope to turn those windmill blades, even though we can't see the wind. That's not a definition of wind. That's just telling you when you can tell that there's wind there, because when you see the windmill blades turning, you know that wind is there causing them to turn. See, and that's evidence. Even though you can't see the wind, the evidence is that your hope is fulfilled. The windmill blades are turning. See, that's not a definition, but yet so many people, radio, television, and churches I've been to, they'll quote this as a definition of faith. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. They'll pronounce it in all kind of funny ways, you know, to try to put emphasis on now faith, or this is the substance. Jesse Duplantis says, since it's a substance, that faith is things. Faith is things. See, everybody comes up with their own definitions like this because it's not a definition, and you can't twist it around and make it a definition. Faith is when we hear God's word, we humble ourselves to God's word and receive it into our heart. If he calls you to teach a Sunday school class, you say, Lord, I've never taught one. He knows you have never taught one. I've never taught one, but I'm going to trust you enough that you'll help me teach that class, and I will do it. See, faith is accepting God's word and God's call to you and trusting that he will help you as you go. You turn to him. Well, Moses didn't want to go. He said, I can't speak. So God gave him a speaker, Aaron, his brother. And then Jeremiah said, I'm too young. God said, I'll put my words in your mouth. It'll be like fire in your soul or fire in your heart or something like this. So many people, even throughout the scriptures, had an excuse of why they couldn't do what God called them to do. And that's the way it is today. But see, there's got to be a first time for each one of us. But God's still got that holy calling, and we got to seek him to that holy calling and be willing to allow him to use us. See? So when we hear God's word, even about, you know, you might be praying about which college to go to or which job to take. Wouldn't that be great to have so many job offers that you'd have to pray about which one to take? Nowadays, just getting a job is the answer. But anyway, things like this. But when God speaks to you to teach that Sunday school class or to teach those young people, and you know God's speaking to you, faith then, you don't accept it by faith. What you do is you accept God's word to faith. Because, see, if you reject his word, it's to unbelief. So unbelief comes by hearing the word of God too. Probably more than faith does, because more people probably reject God's words. You look in our society, there's more people rejecting God's word than they are accepting, that's for sure. So there's more unbelief in our society than there is faith. But yet, you have to hear God's word, and then you choose of your own free will to receive his word into your heart. That's what we call faith, receiving God's word in agreement into your heart. Trust him enough, like Jehoshaphat, surrounded by three armies. And he said he feared, set himself to seek the Lord. And God said, march out of the gate, singing praises, and it's my battle and not yours. Well, Jehoshaphat had to trust God enough, he and his people, to march out of the gates without weapons. See, it took a lot of trust. But see, trust and faith are different. But they trusted God enough, they accepted his word. This is 2 Chronicles chapter 20. Verses, first 20-something verses. But they trusted God enough that they actually, the next morning, got up and went out and marched out of those gates singing praises before the Lord. And God set ambushments against all those armies like that, and they all killed each other to the last person. Now, it just, they had to trust him enough to accept his word of faith. They had to trust him enough that he would go before them. They had to trust him enough that he would actually provide the victory. See, so when he calls you to teach a Sunday school class, you got to trust that he'll go with you and help you teach that class. You got to trust if he asks you to speak up at a service station to someone, that he has that person's heart prepared and he wants you to share with that person, and that he'll go with you and help you do it. See, you've got to learn to trust the Lord to accept his personal words to you to faith. And that's what it means that the just shall live by faith. That is daily, like today now, the rest of the day today, as God leads me to people and everything like that, I won't just be speaking here on the radio today and then shut off and say, okay, I've done my ministry today and I won't be back again until I'm on the radio again or something like that. No. As soon as I get off of this and I go somewhere, God's going to be expecting me to share with that person just as much as I'm sharing with you right now if he speaks to me and makes the circumstances available. See, we are the priest in our world. You and I are the priest, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, and that's us as Christians. We're supposed to be sharing daily throughout wherever we go, to minister to people, to share with them, to help them, you know, learn about God and to have that testimony that overcomes the devil. They overcame him, speaking of the devil, by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony, to share with others anywhere, anytime. And we got to trust him enough that he'll go before us, that he'll have them prepared, that he'll, you know, want us to share with them in a way. Anyway, so see, that's what it's like, you know. Hebrews 11:1 is not a definition of faith. It's talking about it. Now, other people teach it. You'll hear people say, place your faith here and place your faith there. And many of you, you know, heard me share about that before. You can't place your faith. If God asks me to teach a Sunday school class, all I can do is accept or reject. If I accept, I'm accepting to faith. If I reject, I'm rejecting unbelief. I haven't got anything from God I can place somewhere. I can't walk over here and place God's call to this person and say, hey, God called me to teach that Sunday school class, but I'm placing my faith right here with you. You can do it. You know, faith is not something you can take out of your back pocket like money and place your faith here and place your faith there and everything. You can either accept God's word into your heart faith, or you can reject unbelief. See, so anytime you hear a preacher say, place your faith, you know he doesn't know what he's talking about, because it's not something you can place here and place there. Now, you can place your confidence, you can place your trust, like Jehoshaphat and them placed their trust in God and accepted his words to faith. When God told David to go over and said, wait for the rustle of the mulberry bush, then I will go before you. That's in 2nd Samuel chapter 5, I think the last about six verses. David had to, you know, tell his generals and everything, hey, we got to go over to Mulberry Bush and sit there and wait until we hear the rustling of the Mulberry Bush. Then God will go before us. Can you imagine what they might have thought about him? This guy crazy now or something? But see, he did it. He trusted God enough to confess to them that we're going to go over there and wait in the rustling of the Mulberry Bush. See, regardless of what they thought about him, if they thought he was crazy or what, he was going to do what God told him to do. Accepting God's word to faith, he went over and did that. Now, if he had rejected and said something like, or changed it, see, if he had changed God's word, say, we got to go over and circle the Mulberry Bush first, and then God will go before us. See, that's not what God told him. He said, go wait for the rustling Mulberry Bush. He said, we got to go over to Mulberry Bush, and we'll all get organized over there and get things ready, and then we'll go. See, any other activity over there around that Mulberry Bush except waiting for the rustling of the Mulberry Bush would have been error on David's part. And like Proverbs, let's see, what is it, 35:6, every word of God is pure, a shield and put their trust in. Add thou not to it, lest they reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. See, if David said, okay, we'll go over there, circle the Mulberry Bush, and then God will go before us, he'd have been found a liar because God wouldn't have went before him. Then that's what that verse means. If we confess something God's told us, and we say that it's God that told us and this is going to happen or whatever's going to happen, and it doesn't, God won't back it up. That's why we need to be clear about sharing faith with people when we're sharing with them about, see, for by grace are you saved through faith. That means when a person hears that they're a sinner, they've got to accept it or reject it. If they accept from God that they're a sinner, then yes, then God will teach them that Jesus is the answer for their sin. That now that you have that sin, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Jesus has already died to pay the price for your sins. You know, he's already taken care of that. So you accept that you're a sinner. You accept that Jesus is the answer for your sin. And now what? Just knowing that is not salvation. The devils believe and tremble. And when Jesus came into prison, they said, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God, why do you torment us for our time? See, they knew that who Jesus was. They confessed who Jesus was, and they knew their time was coming. So once you know you're a sinner and Jesus' answer, just knowing that's not salvation, but it'll get you there if you respond correctly, like, what is it, Romans 10:13, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You call with all your heart and say, Lord, please forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. Create in me the new heart, the new life, and I commit my life to you. Jesus, in your name I pray. Amen. See, you got to respond correctly to it. In fact, it says that in, let's see, where is that? In Hebrews chapter 2, verse 4, it says, for unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. See, hearing the gospel, all of the good news of the gospel and everything won't profit anybody unless they mix it in faith. And what does it mean, mix it in faith? Accept it and receive it into your heart. Because see, God's word, Jesus says, my words are spirit and they are life. So the spirit of his words of the gospel then that you hear in your head, you've received the spirit of those words into your heart, then they come into your heart and become the spirit of his word working and creating the new heart, the new life. And that's what we call the work of grace then. So by faith, we accept and receive his words and his spirit in our heart. We're saved by grace, the work of his spirit in our heart, in creating the new heart, the new life in us. See, so we've got to share that, you know, clearly and simply with people to realize that all they're doing is just surrendering their life to the Lord, inviting him to come in and create the new heart. Now, and Jesus says, you must be born again. See, that's how we're born into the family of God. When his spirit comes in us and creates in us that new heart and he lives in us in, now we're joint heirs with Jesus. Galatians 4:6 says, and because you're sons, God has sent forth the spirit of his son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father, wherefore you no more a servant but a son. If a son, then heir of God through Christ. We're no longer just his creation, servants and things like that, but we're his children then. Children of God, his spirit living in us because we just invited him to come in and create his new heart. We must be born again to receive the spirit of Christ into our heart. Romans 8:9 says, now if you're not in the flesh, but in the spirit. If so be the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. See, that's the dividing point of being a creature of God that God loves with perfect love and wants to forgive. But the dividing point in between just being a creature of God and being a child of God is when the Spirit of Christ, and like Romans 8:9 says, now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. When the Spirit of Christ comes in your heart, now you're joint heir with Jesus, a child of God. Your eternity is taken care of from then on, because when, like it says in Ezekiel, a new heart also will give you, a new spirit will I put within you. I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh, give you heart of flesh, and put my Spirit in you. When he creates in us that new heart, new life, Christ is the only creator in the universe. God speaks. Christ, his living word, goes forth and creates. Well, when Christ comes in our heart and creates a new heart, there is no verse in the Bible anywhere that Christ will ever come back to you and unchange your heart and create back in you that old heart you had before. There is no, you know, losing your salvation once you receive Christ in your heart. Now, if you make some kind of commitment, decide you're going to start going to church and everything be good, and then 6-7 years later you say, well, I can make more money doing something else, you know, and you make choice and you do this and you do this. No, it's not you when Christ comes in your heart. It's Christ, the living, creating power of God, Christ in your heart, creating the new heart, the new life. And he has promised several times in the scripture he will never lose any of us. I don't know why anybody would want to turn from everything after receiving him in their heart. Just talking about people who think they're, you know, intellectually Christians or something like that. Or like I was all those 20 years thinking I was a Christian, you know, like that. A lot of times I'd, you know, turn from the Lord for years and then go back and everything. But anyway, Christ in us creating the new heart. There's nothing in the scriptures about God uncreating our heart. That's ridiculous. But anyway, my eternal salvation and my eternal life started in 1974 when Christ came into my heart, and he'll never leave my heart. Regardless of what I do, you know, we still commit acts of sin, but we'll never have a separation of our heart from God again. But we're going to have to answer for it at the judgment seat of Christ, which I've been mentioning all along this morning, you know, several of these things. Teaching that, you know, all people have faith is so misleading, because so many people can sit on the church pews in thinking they got faith because they hear and know a lot of God's word. But you only have faith for the scriptures that you've received into your heart. See, God's word into your heart. If you're rejecting God's word from your heart, it's unbelief. So just hearing and knowing and memorizing a lot of scriptures doesn't indicate that you have a lot of faith. You have a lot of knowledge. But you've got to receive them into your heart. And it's difficult to tell the difference in receiving them into your heart and knowing them in your head, except that when you receive them into your heart, the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of those scriptures, work in you and create in you the new heart, the new life. And it's not just from decisions that you decide to make and everything. If you've never received the changed heart, changed life, you need to seek the Lord until you know that you have, that you know that Christ lives in you. If you see yourself as a sinner with a heart full of lust and hate and all this type of stuff, and you turn to the Lord and he erases that and puts his Spirit in you, you will know it. If you have not recognized that change, the changed heart, being born again into the Spirit of God, that's the should be the top of your list. And I'm going to continue these the next time like that, because I didn't get very far through it. But there are so many things that we need to look for, but that needs to be the top of our list to make sure that we receive the changed heart, because Romans 8:9 says, now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. So that's the dividing point between being just a creature, a servant of God, and being a Christian, a child of God. And like Colossians 1:27 says, Christ in us, the living word of God in us, our hope of glory. Good day, and God bless you. Each of my programs are being saved so that you can listen to them at any time. There's just 4 simple steps to find the past programs. Go to www.spreaker, spreaker.com. That's spreaker.com. Enter my name, Richard Hardin, in the search box in the top center of the home page. Click on the brown icon, which has the Bible, two candlesticks, and a cross in the background. A list of my programs will come up.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.